गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडेज टॉपिक इज क्रॉनिक ऑब्स्ट्रक्टिव पल्मोनरी डिजीज. लेट अस सी द डेफिनेशन. इट इज कैरेक्टराइज्ड बाय एयर फ्लो लिमिटेशन विच इज नॉट फुल्ली रिवर्सिबल. दैट मीन्स इन सीओपीडी द एयरवे, दैट इज द साइज ऑफ द एयरवे विल बी रिड्यूस्ड आइदर ड्यू टू रिपीटेड इन्फ्लेमेशन, ड्यू टू म्यूकस क्लॉगिंग, ड्यू टू फाइब्रोसिस. देयर विल बी the lumen of the airway will be narrowed, and this is not a reversible process. Chronically or gradually the symptoms will worsen. Gradually the airway will become more narrow and the patient will find hard to breathe. So in the definition, in the slide, it is written that gradually the patient finds difficult to breathe. The symptoms of COPD are progressively worsening and causes difficulty in breathing even at rest. This is given by WHO. Let us see the pathophysiology. In COPD, the air flow limitation, that is inflow of air through the airways, is limited. It is progressive, as I had already said in the definition. It is associated with abnormal inflammatory response to the lungs, to noxious particles and gases. The inflammatory process occurs throughout the proximal and distal airways. This inflammation occurs in the proximal airways as well as distal airways. Due to chronic inflammation, there will be permanent change in the airway. In larger airways, there will be more secretion of mucus. In smaller airway, there is fibrosis, airway thickening, there will be formation of exudates. So there will be overall airway narrowing. With increasing time, the scar tissue will cause narrowing of the air lumen. Also, repeated inflammation causes alveolar wall destruction, leading to the loss of alveolar attachment and decrease in the elasticity of alveoli. Due to repeated inflammation, there can be change in pulmonary small vessels also, or pulmonary capillaries which are attached to the alveoli. There will be formation of scars or thickening of the pulmonary small vessels, causing pulmonary hypertension in cases of COPD. Now, COPD can be broadly classified, or it has two entities. The disease has two different entities. One is emphysema, another is chronic bronchitis. Let us first see the chronic bronchitis. Cause of chronic bronchitis is mainly smoking. In chronic bronchitis, there is constant irritation of airways, which causes increased mucus secretion by the goblet cells. So the walls of the bronchi gets thickened. There is narrowing of the lumen of the bronchi. It will cause mucus plugging of airways and reduced ciliary function of the bronchi. The alveoli attached to the bronchioles is also damaged and fibrosed, resulting in altered function of alveoli macrophage. Then, due to the destruction of macrophages, it causes increased susceptibility of infection. So in chronic bronchitis, there is repeated chest infection, lot of cough and sputum production. Then the second entity is emphysema. What happens in emphysema is that in emphysema, there is abnormal distension of air spaces beyond the terminal bronchioles with the destruction of the wall of alveoli. In emphysema, the elasticity of the alveoli gets lost and air will be trapped inside, and that air will not move outward. So the alveolar area is not involved in gas exchange, and there is more and more dead space. Impaired gas exchange occur due to the destruction of the wall of distended alveoli. And why the walls of the alveoli gets damaged? It is due to repeated inflammatory process. Now the risk factors of COPD are, first is any cigarette smoking. Passive smoking is also harmful. It is also a risk factor. Then air pollutants, then occupational exposure to dust, chemicals. Then genetic factor is also found, deficiency of alpha antitrypsin enzyme. Alpha antitrypsin enzyme helps to protect the lung tissue. Deficiency of antitrypsin enzyme will fasten, or it will increase the progress of destruction of lung tissue, and it is also found in, this deficiency is also found in some of the COPD patients. Let us see the clinical features of COPD. In all the COPD patients, there will be cough, sputum and dyspnea. Dyspnea on exertion first, and when the disease progresses, the patient will also experience dyspnea even at rest. Then the shape of the thoracic cavity also changes. It causes barrel chest. How to diagnose COPD? Diagnosis is done by PFT, pulmonary function test. Pulmonary function test is also used to assess the severity of the disease, how severe the disease has progressed, and also to monitor whether the disease has improved or not, or the symptoms have improved or not. In PFT, one of the important findings is that in COPD there is a reduction in the volume of forced expiratory volume. That means the expiration is the volume of expiration, volume of air which is expired, you know, that is reduced. Then the second diagnostic test is ABG. In ABG, there is low partial pressure of oxygen, high partial pressure of carbon dioxide, and the third test which you can do is chest X-ray, in which the shape of the thoracic cavity will be changed in case of advanced COPD or in cases of emphysema. Let us see the complications. Complications, definitely it can cause respiratory insufficiency or respiratory failure. Then due to lot of mucus secretions, and the patient is not able to cough out those secretions, there can be pneumonitis, and there is also pulmonary artery hypertension. Next, we will see about the medical management. The goal of the management is to reduce the symptoms and also to improve the quality of life, because it is a chronic disease and the disease progresses. So the aim is to better the quality of the life so that the person performs most of his activity of daily living without any assistance. So in medical management, first it is advised to stop smoking. Second, oxygen therapy can be given to improve the condition of the patient. Then bronchodilators. The detail of the bronchodilators you can go through in any book also. The actions of the bronchodilators are given in the textbooks. Bronchodilators can be given either through nebulizer or metered dose inhaler, MDI. The drugs, some of the drugs which are used as bronchodilators are albuterol, salbutamol. They come in beta adrenergic agonist. Next is anticholinergic drugs, drugs which will reduce the secretions like ipratropium. Then methylxanthine, it is also one of the type of bronchodilators. In this group, examples are aminophylline, theophylline. Corticosteroids will also reduce overall inflammation in long term. In all cases of COPD, pulmonary rehabilitation is an important part of the medical management. How to do the pulmonary rehabilitation? We have to teach the patient education. We have to educate the patient, like we have to stop smoking, then avoid going to the crowded place, doing deep breathing exercises. Then we have to teach about the breathing exercise, like diaphragmatic breathing, pursed lip breathing. Then space the activities so that the patient does not get fatigued. Then exercise training, it is also very useful for the COPD patients to improve the quality of life, so that the breathing capacity is increased and the person can do his activities properly. Exercise is very helpful to reduce the fatigue of the patient. Graded exercise is a important therapy in pulmonary rehabilitation. Then nutritional therapy, we have to see the maintain the nutrition and hydration of the patient. Nursing management, the aim of the nursing management is to control the symptoms and also to improve the quality of life. That means we are in the hospital, when the patient comes with COPD, we have to monitor the patient and prevent the complications related to COPD. And when the patient gets discharged, then we have to focus on pulmonary rehabilitation so that the person achieves a greater or improved quality of life. So to summarize the nursing management, we can say that we have to first see the airway is clear or not, that is airway clearance. Then improve the breathing pattern. How we can do it? Examples are by diaphragmatic breathing, pursed lip breathing. Then monitoring the patient for complications, like we have to see the pulse oximetry readings. Then we have to see the signs of respiratory failure, monitor and prevent respiratory infections. After that, we have to provide oxygen to the patient, educating the patient, like for example, we have to teach exercise. Then we have to teach the patient to avoid dust, fumes, smokes, extreme of temperature, etc. Then maintain hydration of the patient. So this is all about the COPD. Please go through a textbook, and if you have any doubt, then you can ask in the WhatsApp group. Thank you, students.